welcome to Business India with me, Tarun. India-Japan bilateral partnership in the areas of trade and infrastructure will receive a boost as India is planning 5 high-speed rail tracks, namely Delhi-Mumbai, Mumbai-Chennai, Delhi-Kolkata, Delhi-Nagpur and Mumbai-Nagpur. These trains are proposed to run at a speed of 300 km per hour or more, with the Japan International Cooperation Agency already giving financial and technical assistance to many infrastructure projects in India, like the Mumbai-Ahmedabad bullet train project, and official development assistance provided for the Delhi Metro Rail project, dedicated freight corridor project, Delhi-Mumbai Industrial Corridor, Chennai-Bangalore Industrial Corridor. This partnership is looking at good time ahead. Joining me on the discussion are Ambassador Bhaskar Balakrishnan and Ambassador Ashok Sajjanar. I request Ambassador Ashok Sajjanar to make his opening comment on this emerging partnership.
You know, as you have said, Arun, thank you very much for the invitation. As you have said very rightly, Japan and India have been participating for the last many years in terms of improving infrastructure in the country. And good infrastructure in the country is absolutely essential. It's a sine qua non for giving a boost to the productivity and efficiency in the country. Also in terms of ease of doing business. So I think all the projects that you have mentioned, whether it is the new high-speed railway networks, whether it is the Chennai-Bengaluru freight corridor, whether it is the Delhi-Mumbai industrial corridor, or the Delhi Metro Rail project under the official development assistance by Japan. These are going to meet a very felt need as far as the country is concerned. Not only will it help the consumers, the ordinary people, the citizens, as it has done in Delhi at the moment. We can see how, what a remarkable transformation in transportation the Delhi Metro has made, but also in terms of improving competitiveness and ease of doing business in India. So I think this is a very important decision that has been taken during the Prime Minister's visit, and it should be pursued with the full vigor and energy.
Okay, I take your point, and on this note I'll go across to Ambassador Bhaskar Balakrishnan for his opening comments on this partnership.
Well, I think this aspect of the partnership is quite promising. As has been mentioned, the Delhi Metro has been a great success. So we have to look at how it was financed and how it was implemented and build upon that in the other new projects which are coming up. I believe the Mumbai-Ahmedabad high-speed railway is one of the earliest ones. So there are a couple of differences between Japan and India. Distances are much larger in India than in Japan. Japan is much more densely populated. We are much more spread out. Then, of course, the profile of the users is somewhat different here than in Japan. And secondly, of course, one cannot, these new high-speed rail have to be a dedicated railway. You cannot have the old railway system running on the same track as the new one. So we have to build totally new, presumably elevated rail, which is going to be cost a lot of money because the distances are large. You can do it for, say, Delhi-Chandigarh or Mumbai-Ahmedabad. But when you look at larger distances, the economics of this need to be worked out very carefully. Also, what will be the terms under which Japan will finance these projects?
Yes.
These are all going to be critical in determining how these projects move ahead.
Okay.
But otherwise, it's a promising beginning.
It's a promising beginning.
We need to do a lot of work on
Ambassador Balakrishnan says. I'm going across to Ambassador Ashok Sajjanar. Now, it's a two-pronged question. The first part of a question is of happening, an incident which happened that Japan lost a high-speed rail project in Indonesia to China. Japan really woke up and ensured that it should not lose such projects in other markets, India being a focus area. Second, with it's a political question with Prime Minister Narendra Modi taking charge as Prime Minister, and he even as Gujarat Chief Minister had visited and seen the Shinkansen or their high-speed network, and he said that why India can't have such networks, or you know, why shouldn't we have such networks. And there was also a reference made that China's rail network until 1980 was, you know, much lesser than what India's network is in terms of length, as well as the speed was almost equivalent, but the length was lesser. Now they are the largest high-speed rail track network in the world. China has one of the largest. So in all this complexity and all these things, what do you see as the emerging relationship between India and Japan? Because Japan will want to grab the Indian market and not lose it to China for any other reason.
Yeah, I think, you know, we have to look at the fact that how the India-Japan relationship has progressed and it has evolved over the last many years. 2000, we had the visit of Prime Minister Mori, and that is what really set the stage for an expansion, deepening and broadening of our relationship. And then we had the global and special partnership in 2006 and annual meetings between the annual summit meetings between the prime ministers. And then 2014, when Prime Minister Modi went to Japan, and I think we need to keep in mind that this was his first bilateral visit outside the South Asian region. He had traveled to Bhutan and to Nepal before that, but this was the first visit outside, a bilateral visit outside South Asia. So that itself indicates the importance and significance that the Prime Minister and this government accords to its relations with Japan. You are very right that in 2015, Japan lost the bid in Indonesia for the high-speed train. As far as India and Japan is are concerned, the agreement was signed last year. During this current visit, it has been decided that the general consultant would be confirmed during this year, during 2016. Construction will start in 2018, and the high-speed rail will be up and running by 2023. So I think there are very specific timelines that have been given. As far as the funding is concerned, that also I think JICA has provided at very highly concessional rates long-term funding on that. I take the point that Ambassador Balakrishnan mentioned that in terms of distances and the nature and the type of consumers and travelers in Japan, it's a little different. But I think it will be useful not to really treat India as a sui generis case, as a unique case. Because I think bigger countries with large territorial area and those which have not been so, people are not so prosperous and so rich who are in a, whose paying capacity is more. For instance, China is an example, and you mentioned yourself that earlier, even as far as the normal rail network was, it was smaller than in India. So we can have a look at how China has been able to do in terms of research, in terms of development, in terms of, you know, getting synergy. Very rightly, most of the developed countries have a synergy between the academia, between universities and the industry and the government. And I think we also need to do that and evolve that. And with the Japan, we are able to get this technology transferred onto India. So with Japan, I would like to underline that it is not only a transactional relationship. It is not only a business relationship. Now what it has evolved from 2014 onwards, it is the special strategic and global partnership. So I think there is a strategic aspect also. And I would be very surprised because that on the basis of the current relations between India and China, that we would be looking positively at China to get their high-speed rail technology or not network into our own country.
Now, Ambassador Balakrishnan, two questions to you. First, both China and Japan have good high-speed rail technology. Now both have acquired. Japanese was a pioneer, but now even China is somebody, you know, who has been doing this in other countries, taking up projects. China has supplied a lot of metro, what you can say, coaches, as you would call them, to us, or rolling stock, as you would call in technical terms. They have supplied that. They have even interest in, you know, also being a part of the high-speed rail projects in this country. But given as the political situation or the strategic situation that has emerged between the two countries, do you think Japan has this opportunity to totally colonize this business in India, or do you think China will also remain a supplier of such technology and goods or rolling stock or projects in India? I mean, what do you see happening in the next 4 to 5 years?
Well, let's first come to the question of the Chinese. You mentioned that China did not have as elaborate a rail network as India had. Now, that's the very reason. If you were a Chinese policymaker and you had to build new railways, you would go for the latest technology.
Yes.
Our position is different. We already have a fairly elaborate railway network, and that railway network needs to have a lot of work done to improve its efficiency, carrying capacity and viability. And that will be a very cost-effective way of going about it. We do need to have additional railway lines. Those can be with the new technology, high speed and so on, we've proven. Now, as far as China and Japan and the railway market in India is concerned, I think the market is big enough for both players.
Okay.
Of course, the Chinese have a disadvantage. Firstly, of course, the political factors are not propitious. Secondly, with China, we lack the kind of transparency and accountability which we have with Japan about the nature of the projects, how viable are they. If they tell us that we are doing a project of 200 miles in China, we do not have enough access to the data and all the things to assess how viable it is. In the case of Japan, everything is open, it's transparent, good business practices.
So Japan does have a significant edge is what you're alluding to. Yeah. I'm going across to Ambassador Sajjanar. Now, both countries, India and Japan, have agreed to jointly work on projects in Africa, or at least this has been talked about. Now, though Japan has fairly good investments in Africa compared to India, of course China is a pioneer, we all know, but how do you see this relationship growing, because both countries have their own interests? How do you see them together working in Africa?
I think that there are good possibilities. You alluded to China having been being in Africa in a very big way. That is right, but it is basically in the area of mineral resources, natural resources. So that is where they are, but I think wherever India has been, it has been more in terms of people to people, whether it is training, it is capacity development, it is human skill development. So I think across the world there are a number of opportunities, and Africa is an area, Africa is a continent, 53 countries of Africa, they are growing, they are, there are more than a dozen countries in Africa which are growing at more than 6-7%, the GDP is growing at more than 6-7%. So that presents good possibilities, very good opportunities. We are all aware that both Japan and India are also looking at working together on the Chabahar project.
Yes.
And that is also extremely important. Why I want to mention Chabahar is also because of its strategic significance in addition to its economic significance. And also the fact that now there is that confidence and the comfort level between India and Japan that they can take up major projects outside the country. So in Africa, from India, there have been a number of high level visits, whether it is of the president, the vice president, the prime minister. So we are reaching out, and obviously it is Japan would also like to reach out. I think there is a complementarity of interest. If Japan has great strengths in manufacturing, India has great strengths in services. So I think there would not be so much of competition as there would be complementarity. And of course, Japan has resources, financial resources, which it would be in a position to invest. So it would be able to go there. And I think both of us could really complement the strengths of the other.
Okay, taking off where Ambassador Sajjanar made two important points. He spoke about the strategic significance of the Chabahar, operation to build and develop the port. Now I'll go across to Ambassador Balakrishnan. Sir, there are two points from what I can see what Ambassador Sajjanar said. There is an axis called the China-Pakistan axis. The India is also trying to develop an axis, say India, Iran and Afghanistan. So, does it help in that axis in a way? Are we bolstering our chances? Second, will trade from Central Asian countries to India be easier with Chabahar being developed? Do you see that happening in the times to come?
Yes, the Chabahar port is of importance to us because it opens up a route to Central Asia and Afghanistan, which is independent of Pakistan. So, in that sense, if that port and the connectivity thereafter inland develops, that will help our trade with that region. The China-Pakistan economic corridor is mainly intended to allow Chinese exports to go out from Gwadar out into Middle East, Africa and Europe. It is not really going to add anything extra to Pakistani exports. So in that sense, really Pakistan is really becoming a tool of the Chinese economy. So there's a big difference here. And now, as far as Africa and Japan cooperating, India and Japan cooperating in Africa is concerned, it's a good idea and it's an interesting idea to take forward in principle. But we must do one thing very, very seriously, and that is to improve the record of implementation of our projects abroad.
I mean, most of our projects. Is that a cause of concern, sir?
It is a cause of a serious concern, because there are many places where we have promised to deliver projects, and the projects have run into time overruns, cost overruns, delays.
Is it at counter with the Chinese efficiency?
Well, it is. You know, it is not that we are inherently more inefficient. It is because our systems for handling these projects are not geared up. If you look at projects in India which the government implements, you can see that there are delays, there are cost overruns. Now, if we go about implementing projects abroad the same way, this is not going to do us any credit.
So that is not going to stand us in good. I'm going across to Ambassador Sajjanar. Ambassador Sajjanar, you have been an ambassador to Kazakhstan, and recently had the opportunity of attending one of your talks on the trade relations between the two countries. Now, if you could share with us, with the Chabahar Airport coming up, how will it help trade of India with these Central Asian countries, which has been lagging for all these years?
Yeah, there is a great complementarity. There is a great deal that India could, India and the Central Asian countries, and not only in terms of trade, but also in terms of, we have great strategic interests in terms of ensuring the stability, security, peace, and fighting with terrorism that would come out of Afghanistan and also Pakistan in that area, because that's a part of our extended neighborhood. So going into Chabahar, because we have really not been able to get access through Pakistan to Central Asia, and that is what has really dwarfed our relationship with this region. So once Chabahar gets developed, we will be able to get access into Afghanistan, we'll be able to get access to Central Asia. There is also a train network that has already been developed from Kazakhstan via Turkmenistan to Iran, and that could connect up to the Chabahar port, and that would help products and goods. We are also looking at energy. There is also a possibility of a pipeline coming down. Of course, we have been speaking about the Tapi, the Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India, but that's a different thing. Coming only to Chabahar, one is in terms of direct linkage with Central Asia, with Afghanistan through the Zaranj-Delaram road that has been constructed by India. So it will provide us with an access to Afghanistan. We will not really have to depend on, taking very, very circuitous routes. This will also be a part of the international north-south transport corridor, which will go through Iran on to Azerbaijan and on to Russia and northern part of Europe. So this is going to be a game changer. It's going to be strategically very important. If you permit, Tarun, I'll just like to make one comment on the observation that was made by Ambassador Balakrishnan. Very relevant observation that our implementation record, our delivery record of projects in other countries has not been something to be very proud of. But of late we have seen that projects which have been languishing for a long time, for instance, you look at the parliament building in Kabul.
Yes.
It had been going on for many, many years. And that when the current government came and the instructions were given that it needs to be completed, it needs to be concluded quickly, it was done. We also look at Salma Dam. Also, it started sometime in the 1990s. Again, about 20 years. But here also, the government gave instructions. It has to be completed. So I think There is that possibility, there is that.
Given the political will is what you are alluding to, the political will of the political establishment of the day so desires.
Absolutely, they can take it forward. And recently when we had the meeting with ASEAN and we had the Myanmar president who had come here and also the counselor and the foreign minister Aung San Suu Kyi.
Yes.
And there are two major projects there. One is the Kaladan multimodal transport project and one is the trilateral highway. And there also it has been going on for many, many years.
Even political will things do happen.
They can happen, yes.
Ambassador Balakrishnan, taking forward from the point that Ambassador Sajjanar made, see, these are isolated incidents where the political establishment of the day, its attention is focused to that project and, you know, things go on fast and are completed in time. Do you think, given the Indian way of working things, this can happen on every project basis? Because then again, in countries where we don't pay attention as much, the projects can be languishing. Do you think this is something that has to be to do with the working ethos of Indians as a whole or Indian government projects as a whole? Can we change it, or do you think this is going to be a pain point for the years to come?
No, of course we can change it. I mean, you know, the projects in India, okay, that's something we can't do because there are a lot of rules and regulations. Now, when you have a project abroad and for every payment which has to be made to a contractor, you have to send the file to the finance ministry for approval,
yes,
even though the project has been approved. And then you have to wait for the finance ministry to clear it. This slows down the whole thing.
So you mean certain procedural bottlenecks,
yes,
are built into the system?
Yes, procedures have to be streamlined. They have to be instructions issued that as far as projects are concerned, the project implementation authority will have the power to disburse the money without having to go each time to the finance ministry.
It's a very significant point made by Ambassador Balakrishnan. Ambassador Sajjanar, now I want you to give us a 10-year view or a 2-decade, a 20-year view. 6 projects have been identified. One small project of metro, your high-speed rail itself costs about 1,20,000 crore. I'm not talking of cost escalations till it is finally developed. Do you think these 6 projects can see the light of the day, or do you think that cost itself is a big deterrent because even 1,20,000 crores is no less a cost?
You know, number one, I will say that there is a good possibility because the India has realized that if we want to up our GDP and if we want to have remove poverty amongst the people, then you need to have higher level of GDP and of course inclusive growth, and infrastructure plays a very significant role, a very important role in enhancing competitiveness and also of course along with that we need to provide jobs. So you know, whether it is inclusive growth or jobs, infrastructure plays a very, very significant role.
Taking off from where Ambassador Sajjanar said, he's focused on infrastructure and very rightly so. Sir, I would request both of you to answer on this count. A, there is not a single industrial development area in the country which can rank as world class in industrial or infrastructure which is provided, be it Pimpri Chinchwad in Maharashtra, which is one of India's largest, be it Talega, or maybe it's something in say Tamil Nadu, or even Noida, closer home, or even if you talk of Gurgaon, no industrial area is world class. In fact, when a Japanese delegation was visiting India, they say that, you know, they were requested to go back because our industrial areas were flooded with water during the rainy season and machines were submerged in water, and this is closer home in Gurgaon. So India faces all these problems. Japan is complete opposite. They've got one of the best industrial areas in the whole wide world. Do you see this is the one area where which could be the success story of the current and the next decade? Ambassador Balakrishnan followed by Ambassador Sajjanar.
Well, I think it's not all that gloomy. I think if you look at some of the industrial areas in Gujarat and Tamil Nadu, they are quite good, comparable to the best in the world. I mean, they may not be, you know, everything may not be as it should be. But by and large, there are models where we have very good industrial infrastructure and industrial zones. That's the reason the automobile industry has grown up very well in Chennai.
Okay,
now what we don't have is a good transportation inland. Okay. So the moment you try to manufacture something in the interior of the country, you face the logistics bottleneck.
That's a very important point.
That's why we are good at
logistics. Costs are highest in the world. 17% is something we are.
So that's the reason why our services have become competitive. Very important. Our industries have lagged.
But since we are running out of time, very quickly, Ambassador Sajjanar, your comment on this.
My comment on this will be, let me also comment on, we have the software technology park. So, when software we have been able to provide those facilities and that infrastructure, I don't see any reason why we shouldn't be able to create industrial parks also. The other point that I would like to make is that even as far as domestic projects are concerned, I think we can complete them on time, of good quality, and without cost overruns. Delhi Metro is a case in point.
Okay.
Also, you see the extension that is happening to different parts, to Noida, to Greater Noida, the sort of the flurry of activity that is taking place. And what is being mentioned is that we are going to be able to complete it even before the due date. So my point is having the sort of leadership there at the helm of affairs, and I think they will be able to deliver. So at every of these projects, which are important projects, which are sensitive projects, we need to have, assign the importance and significance and put a leadership which can take it forward.
Okay. Yeah, world taking class, off, so they're actually completely out of time. Would have to love to have discussed it more. But yes, India and Japan's strategic and global partnership is poised for success in the coming decade, especially projects of strategic importance like the Chabahar port, also investments in infrastructure, high-speed rail. Let us see how all this pans out in the coming years. We'll track it for you here on News World India. But thank you so much for joining us on today's discussion of Business India. Thank you.